In this lecture, we want to learn how to identify overconstrained cases where making blind use of the formulation might lead to an incorrect answer. We will also have some examples to practice how to utilize the formulation with caution and find the correct degrees of freedom. Let's start with an example. Imagine we have this picture frame installed to the wall by means of 4 pins. Let's use the formulation to compute the degrees of freedom. 3 times just one body minus 2 times 4 pins becomes minus 5. This example demonstrates that the formulation we are using does not always work. Notice that in the world of rigid bodies, a negative degrees of freedom is meaningless, and the minimum value for the degrees of freedom is 0. You remember that we also had another approach, where we reconstruct the system and gradually bring the rigid bodies and add to the degrees of freedom, and then bring the constraints and reduce them. Let's try the reconstruction approach, which might probably perform better. Assuming that this picture frame is a rigid body, it brings 3 degrees of freedom to the system. 1, 1, 1. With this pin here, the system loses 2 degrees, meaning that at this point, the frame cannot move. Neither this way nor this way. This loss is on behalf of eliminating this motion. And this one is on behalf of eliminating this motion. This remaining degree says this frame can rotate around this pin. Now let's add the second pin here. But before adding it, let's focus on the possible motions of this point of the frame. Obviously, this motion is possible and causes the rotation of the frame around the other pin. But do you think this motion is possible? Considering this pin here, if this point moves this way, then this side of the frame needs to be stretched, which is not possible just because the frame is rigid. Therefore, this motion is not allowed due to presence of this pin. Now let's add the second pin. It should potentially eliminate these two motions. Eliminating this motion is equivalent to canceling this rotation. But eliminating this motion by the second pin is not a new loss, and in fact is repeat of this loss. Meaning that the second pin took only 1 degree because the other degree had already been taken. More interestingly, if we keep adding more pins, like a third or fourth one, there is no more degrees left for them to cancel, because what they could cancel have already been cancelled. Let's see another example. Firstly, we apply the formulation. The degrees of freedom is 3 times 1, 2, 3, 4, 4 bodies, minus 2 times 1, 2, 3, 4 pins and 1, 2 prismatic joints. So J1 is 4 plus 2 or 6. And the degrees of freedom is 0, which does not seem to be correct. What do you think went wrong? The problem is here. This link is connected to the ground with 2 pins. In fact, this first pin takes 2 degrees among the 3 degrees that this link brings. The second pin can take only the remaining rotation, so it takes only 1 degree instead of 2. Therefore, the degrees of freedom of the system is 1 instead of 0. Alternately, we could say, since this sling has two pins, it is rigidly connected to the ground and can be considered as continuation of the ground. This way, the number of bodies is 3 instead of 4, and the number of J1 is 4 instead of 6, and the degrees of freedom becomes 1, which is the correct answer. So with this example, we learned that we can still use the formulation as long as we are careful about overconstrained cases, such as when two bodies are connected to each other by more than one revolute joint. In this last example, again, we see the orange link is connected to the ground with two pins, which, as we know, is equivalent to a rigid joint. So we can consider this link as the continuation of the ground. Therefore, the degrees of freedom is 3 times 3 bodies, including 2 sliders and the big triangle, minus 2 times J1, which is 4, including 2 revolute and 2 prismatic joints. And the degrees of freedom is 1.